You're listening to Amped Radio.
Amped Radio.
Internet radio that will blow your frickin' mind.
Thank you for visiting the Bolin Alley, the home of Bolin Services. We're the star makers and risk takers, but don't f*** with us or we'll break you. Don't believe us? Just ask the Iron Sheik and John Cena Sr. We'll now take you to your entertainment for tonight. The star maker Kenny the King Bolin and Chris the Prince Bolin.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to a new edition of the Bolin Alley. This is the third edition. It's June 7th, 2011. I've got two of the biggest managers ever to step foot in the wrestling business.
Only second-generation manager. I'd like that stated.
The only second-generation manager. But hey, guys, I've got some great intros for you guys that I even prepared. So listen to this.
I love a good intro.
All right, first we've got the man. He's helped mold and create some of the biggest wrestling stars on the planet. Jimmy Cornette can't light a candle to this man. He was the king before Jerry Lawler. He was the king before Harley Race.
And well, even, that's for damn sure.
And even the king of kings before that bastard son-in-law in World Whatever Entertainment. He is the star maker himself, Kenny the King Bolin.
He is a bastard son-in-law, that's without a doubt. He just shows up once a year, does Mania, goes away, impregnates the thing, comes back next year, another
gets
Mania.
Another 18-year contract extension.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, he's great. He's great. We're all great.
Eric, my genius cousin we referred to in the past, is he calls Stephanie the box the game comes in.
I love it. I love it. Stephanie is the box the game comes in. Yeah. So, you heard it here first, ladies and gentlemen. We'll give Cousin Eric credit for that one.
And next,
Eric Einstein.
We've got the hottest wrestling manager in the industry today.
I'd say hands down.
Hands down. Some say he taught Mike Awesome how to tie a knot.
Some say.
Some say he has more talent and charisma in the tip of his pinky finger than Sean Waltman had in his entire shitty career.
I'd say that's a given.
I don't think anybody needs to say that. Most are saying that.
he may just have more heat than his pops. And he's a chip off the old block. He is Chris the Prince Bolin.
I am indeed. I enjoyed those intros immensely. But let's get on with the show. We haven't done one of these in a while.
Yeah, we've done forgot how to do one.
Yeah.
All right, guys. It's been close.
It's been rusty.
Yeah, been close to what? 3 weeks? A month?
Three, 4 weeks thereabout. We've been teasing his super manager show, and of course Cornette's been fucking around. He's still thinking he's in the wrestling business, and he signed a 22 station deal, 39 station deal. I don't know; depends who you listen to. Bischoff or him.
Well,
he's all excited about his new ROH project, and he's got a lot of work going on there, and contracts being handed out and divvied out, and all this nonsense. And so we're hoping to have him aboard. One day next week or the week after at the latest. And Paul Bearer, the nicest guy in the world, he's just
waiting
for Cornette to get off the pot so all of us can take a shit in this great manager commode we're going to be dumping in.
Well, that was a horrible analogy.
That's about as bad as you can get.
All right, guys. Well, the last 3 weeks has been kind of...
Tonight's Bolin Alley, by the way, brought to you by the good folks at Vanilla Coke.
Zero. Run a diet in the Bolin household.
Vanilla Coke Zero. Just trying to drop a pound or two here.
Oh, yeah. Don't have your Pepsi throwback going on?
No, there's no throwback this week. I'm not even sure that they're still selling the throwbacks.
We did have the throwback, but I think the throwbacks are...
Promotional?
Promotional discontinuation or something for the time being.
They're seasonal. They're a seasonal promotional item that has gone out of season.
Yeah, they're there. They should be back.
Speaking of things that are out of season, fuck the English TV schedule. Goddamn Doctor Who, in its best season since 1965, is they hit you with this huge cliffhanger, and then they go on hiatus for 2 months.
Well, not only a huge cliffhanger there, but over here on American television, The Mentalist.
Mm.
Well, you like The Mentalist. You've admitted
it's no Doctor Who.
I haven't showed you that last 7 minutes yet. Wait till you see that finish. And, of course, The Office has left us with a big finish. That's a ripoff of British television.
It is a clone.
We got a big finish there. We don't know who the new office manager is going to be. Could be Jim Carrey. Could be Raymond from Everybody Hates Raymond.
God, I hope they cancel it.
Everybody did hate Raymond. And James Spader was up for the job. He may want it, yes.
Wow.
Spader's up. He was very impressive.
Spader's above that.
Well, he was there applying for the jobs, all I'm saying.
He's better than
And he told him he was above the job.
Well, I'm glad he listened.
And that he really didn't want it. And then the more he tried to talk himself out of it, the more he damn near got it. And I know this isn't what you call wrestling news to get right off the start here, but...
Has anything happened in the wrestling
business? It's about the only fucking thing that's entertained us in quite some time. Not a lot of it happening on wrestling shows, but we're going to do our best. I've actually watched a little bit of wrestling.
I have not.
Well, I take that back. I ain't seen a fucking bit of wrestling, but I have seen a little bit of WWE.
The only wrestling I have watched since the last time we did an alley, other than OVW, which I'm on, is that Real Japan show I watched with you and Raul.
I did see a 1975 match with Jerry Lawler and Robert Fuller that was pretty good, that had Nick Gulas and Jackie Fargo on the card as well.
I watched low-budget Japanese indie wrestling.
There you go. So you've seen what we've heard and seen.
If you'd like to ask me a question about anybody that Satoru Sayama has trained, please feel free.
Well, believe it or not, guys, there's actually been quite a bit that's happened within the past...
No, horseshit.
I find this incredible.
Horseshit. All right, go ahead.
Got plenty for you.
I may have seen some of it.
I haven't.
First and foremost, the most important thing that's happened in the last month is the death of Macho Man Randy Savage. So I know that you guys have, had a little bit of a feud and stuff going on there, but...
We had a big feud with him for quite a while.
We stole his website.
As a matter of fact, I've been listening to those old bowling alleys in my car, courtesy to... do you want to mention the name of the man that sent us all those? Do you want to give him some credit?
Sure, go ahead.
Well, you go ahead, because I can't think of his name.
I haven't got his name.
I'm an ass. I couldn't think of his name. I was going to put the burden on you.
Well, once I can think of his name, I will put it up on the
website.
All right,
whatever his name. And hey, don't be offended, because I have many relatives that I have seen on a yearly basis for the last 40 years, and I couldn't fucking tell you who they are to save my life. I'm just not good with names. But you're a very nice man. You know who you are. You know the... It ain't Josh. Is it Josh?
Let me see.
Jason? We're not treating the guy right here. One of us is going to have to pull his name up.
I've got it right here. Hold on just a second.
Yeah, he's got a name, and people ought to know it. Prince is bored.
We're fucking
Prince
terrible.
Real bored.
Let's see here. Jason.
Misty, you on the show this week?
Our Labrador has joined
us. Yeah, our Labrador is coming in here to add a third voice to all this.
Jason Bradley.
That's it. Josh Jason Bradley. That's the guy.
All right, so the death of Macho Man Randy Savage, very important issue. We said some terrible things back in the old alley days. I regret none of them. They reflected our feelings at the moment.
Well, plus they were accurate.
We didn't make anything up about him. I mean,
all in the defense of Steve Wilton,
who's a fantastic human being.
We've had no problems with him.
And honestly, I'm sorry that he's gone from a wrestling perspective. I think that he was a fantastic talent. I think that he contributed greatly to what real wrestling became in the 90s through his match with Steamboat that everybody remembers, and I think most of the technical guys got into the business because of. But as far as the Randy Savage that I knew and that I read about and I've heard stories about all my life, I really don't regret anything that I said. I feel as though it was all justified.
And the thing I got to point out is Randy Savage was the first professional to try to recruit me into the wrestling business. He wrote me a letter that I've got around here somewhere, a handwritten and a partially typed letter from ICW wanting me to join their wrestling organization when they found out how tight I was with Miss Jarrett, Jerry Jarrett, and the Cornettes and Lawlers. I think they thought they were going to be stealing one if they got me to join them. But the Jarretts, Miss Jarrett, Christine Jarrett, was the one that told me, is that if you join them, your ties with us will be gone. So I elected to not venture that way. And plus, I really had no intentions of it anyway. I just showed them the letter and asked them what they thought. And then it still took them 8 years to get me into the business after that. So
Bob Roop was in SCW, wasn't he?
Bob Roop was there. Garvin was there. Of course, Lanny was.
Yeah, Lanny inside.
Lanny was doing perverted things there, I'm sure.
Yeah, I'm sure Rip Rogers knows a story or two.
The Hustler Rip Rogers was there. So they had a decent roster. It was just.
Pez Watley there?
Badly put. Pez Watley was there for a little bit. It was just a very, very studio show that was trying to copy Memphis but not doing a very good job.
The one thing that I remember about those shows that I've seen, I haven't seen many, but I've seen more than most people, is they continually mentioned Memphis. They continually tried to get themselves acknowledged by Memphis.
And you're automatically, anytime you mention the competition, you automatically are admitting you're number two or lower than that.
And when they would continually acknowledge that Memphis was ignoring them, it made them seem even more low budget.
The only company you've ever heard OVW ever mention is if we mention a WWE affiliation. And that
ROH would, guys normally get plugged.
And, well, I mean, we might plug upcoming ROH shows, but I'm talking.
Well, I mean, on Hero,
I'm talking about rival companies around Kentucky. You would never, ever hear OVW ever mention any of them.
Are there any companies in Kentucky?
Well, according to the State Athletic Commission, no.
What else you got for us? I think we've covered Randy.
What's next?
Next on that list was, I don't know if you heard about Brian Knobbs mocking his death.
I did hear about it. I can kind of take or leave Knobbs. I really don't really have any feelings toward him one way or the other. I'm sure he was just trying to be a funny guy. I'm a guy who will try and find humor probably at the wrong time at times as well. And
for me, it's a coping mechanism. I always try to make light of the worst situation I can, because then it's like it's not so bad. So he may have been doing that.
Yeah. What I did read, I don't recall what I read. I just recall it didn't appear to be all that bad to me.
Yeah.
Right.
I don't think anything horribly mean was meant by it from what I read. Gotcha. So I didn't really take. And like I said, I could take not, you know.
I never really.
I feel whatever career they had was a gift from Hulk Hogan.
Yeah.
So like I said, I wouldn't be looking to book either one of them in OVW to boost attendance. But I don't think he meant any real harm out of what he said.
If you look at the Road Warriors and the Nasty Boys, I think you see where the business went.
Yeah.
Except for the Dudleys, obviously.
Right, right.
Yeah, if Hulk and Animal are calling me today, if they were both still alive and called me today, yeah, I think we, attendance gets boosted tremendously at OVW next week. If the Knobs and Sags call me, there may be people turn in their tickets that had already bought them from this week.
Actually, you know, I'm going to debate you on that. And it's not any disrespect to the Road Warriors. They're a fantastic tag team, probably the best overall as far as drawing power goes of that era. But I don't think that they would make a difference in attendance these days. I don't think that anybody can. I don't think that there's...
I think they would for a period of time. It might only be a few weeks, but if the Road Warriors had never set foot in OVW, much like Jerry Lawler has never set foot in Davis Arena. He has been to Six Flags, he's been to the Gardens, but the day they hear Jerry Lawler's coming to the OVW Arena, it's going to be an impact.
I'm not giving you this one. I say we dig up Hawk, we pay Animal, and we put him on and see what happens. But
now, Hawk was a friend of mine.
I love Hawk.
Cut some promos for me. Don't you be going saying bad things about Hawk.
I'm not
Hawk.
Saying a damn bad thing about Hawk.
You said dig him up, and we don't go digging up the dead just to try to boost attendance.
We did it with IRS once.
Well, Nick Gulas may have done it, but...
We did it with IRS once.
Well, we didn't book him at OVW, did we?
No, we put him on the
We wouldn't book him here if he was alive.
Actually, I like Rotunda.
I do, too.
I think he's a great talent, but
and it was
sad about the way
he was. A bit of a shock when he walked in the door at OVW that week after I thought that he was dead. But
no, I don't think there's any of those guys that are left that will actually draw a house. I mean, the Garvins, nothing. The Road Warriors, well, obviously they can't, but I don't think they would give.
Well, I'm talking OVW. I'm not talking that they're going to put 10,000 more seats on the WWE OVW. Show.
I really, it might be 15 people's difference.
And I'm saying the Freebirds, Michael Hayes, Freebirds for a few weeks would make a difference. Hawk and Animal, I totally disagree with you.
I don't see it.
But no, that's where I'm telling you.
Sags and Nobbs.
The Nasty Girls are not going to make any impact.
I think that as far as putting over a tag team here, the Road Warriors would help us draw that way. But individually, off of just being the Road Warriors, I don't see it.
And the sad thing is, I bet you if the APA was coming here next week, maybe not. Maybe not that much.
I'd give maybe 10 tickets for it.
And that's a shame because the APA was a very entertaining team.
They were a great team.
And did us a lot of good when they were here helping out earlier.
Bradshaw was always good down here.
But these days, I don't know if these fans, they forget about you real quick when you're not in the limelight.
Billy Gunn and BG James, don't think they would draw anything.
Make sure we talk about Stone Cold today. I got a few things to say about that whenever we get to it, unless you've already got a Stone Cold question.
I don't have a Stone Cold question.
Well, I tell you what, did you read my posting about the Tough Enough winner?
I saw it. I haven't read the whole thing, but
what
I
a crock of dog shit.
I have no idea. I didn't see it.
A guy named Andy won Tough Enough. He was so close to being cut on two or three different occasions, it wasn't funny. I don't see what the hell they're looking at. He's not that fucking big anyway. He's big, but not that big.
Like Asher Knight big?
Bigger than Asher Knight. He's got the long hair, a little bit.
I'm so sick of the long hair look.
Yeah, and he cried when he almost got cut. And he's got this phony ass mean streak when he wants to mean it up and be. He's so phony. And, There were probably at least six other guys on that show that deserved an opportunity over him.
When Matt Cross got eliminated, I quit caring.
The guy, the country boy with no teeth, he'll have more impact. You could tell when they were introduced to the crowd, you could tell who got over with the crowd and who didn't, and he didn't. The story about him and the wife and the two kids. You know, that's the only thing that they could promote. Well, Andy.
I remember seeing him in the premiere. I didn't see anything. I never saw him.
Yeah, he's got a wife at home pregnant. He's got a kid, and he's got the.
I mean,
like I said, he ain't that big. And then the other guy is Miz Ripoff Light. Have you watched any of the Tough Enoughs?
I've watched a couple of them. I know who you're.
Well, they're excellent
about.
Shows. I won't miss them because when Stone Cold gets in the ring to eliminate you, that is some of the most entertaining shit going on TV today. And the ratings have not been bad. Their ratings have been well over a million five for every one of them they've done.
Gotcha.
But no, the guy that won it's a crock of shit, and I'm telling you right now, I said it about Sheamus, and I'll say it about this guy. He ain't going to mount the dick in the WWE. He does not have what it takes.
Why is Sheamus still around? They don't run Ireland.
Well, Ricky Steamboat took credit on Tough Enough last night. FCW has trained such stars as Dolph Ziggler.
No.
No, you didn't. Wade Barrett. No, you didn't. And Sheamus. Well, you can have that. You can have all the Sheamus you want.
Yeah.
He never set foot in OVW, and if he had, we'd have sent him home the next day.
We'd have run him out of here.
Hey, pale fuck, you need to go home.
Oh, my God. I mean, my hatred of the Irish aside, the man is useless.
Well, and I told everybody that, and I've had people argue with me. I don't know if Dickens been one of them.
I have
or
an
not.
IQ of 150.
Nah, I can't I cannot fucking stand him.
Yeah. And,
he adds absolutely nothing to the
there's
show.
There's some of my loyalists on my wall on Facebook have come around and said, King, you called it. You said he wasn't going to mount to shit, and apparently he's not going to.
Abe Knuckleball Schwartz will go down as a more relevant aspect.
I like that name better than Sheamus.
It was a fantastic
Abe
name.
Abe Knuckleball Schwartz. But but you had mentioned off air that Wade Barrett had made a comment about him being trained by FCW. What did he say?
Yes, he said, now this is a quote from, I'm sure it was fed by WWE, but this is what he said.
Yeah, let's hear it.
When I came over from England and I was just starting out, it was here at FCW that I planted my roots.
He's blind, fucker.
Wasn't he teamed up with Burchill here for like a year?
Yeah, him and Paul Burchill were here forever.
And they were fantastic.
And did a hell of a job. Yeah. And Burchill was better than Barrett.
Burchill was better than most of that fucking roster.
Well, yeah, absolutely.
I'm saying it now, and I hope Paul hears this. I sincerely do. He should be on top of that company right now, and they're a bunch of fucking idiots.
Well, he won't hear it because Paul's a fireman down the road here.
Is
a little
he?
Bit. Yeah, Paul Burchill's a fireman.
What?
Yeah, down in like around Fort Knox.
No way.
Yeah, he's a fireman. Someone talked him into wrestling a tribute show here recently, and that was about it.
Paul Burchill was fucking fantastic.
Yeah. He got the pirate gimmick over, which was doomed for failure.
Yeah,
he got it over.
They were trying to bury him because he was one of our guys, and they gave him that stupid fucking pirate gimmick, and he made it work.
Got his roots in FCW, my ass. That's the biggest crock of shit, and I'll call anybody in the goddamn company a liar. And then Wade Barrett, I don't think if you asked him, would actually say it if you asked him face to face.
I remember plenty of house shows with him and Burchill putting on damn good matches.
Yeah, him and Burchill kicked ass when they were here in OVW. They got, and as bad as I hate to say it, I think Heyman kind of put them together, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, that was Heyman era.
That's the closest thing to anything right Heyman did with the whole time he was here. But nah, Burchill was even better than Barrett. If it had been used right, it'd still be that way. Barrett was good.
I like Barrett.
But Burchill was way ahead of Barrett.
Barrett's one of the only guys up there that I actually enjoy watching, but Paul Burchill not being a main event draw there is unforgivable. The man had everything.
It's sad.
He was a fucking good promo. He was a fantastic worker. He could do crazy flying shit that Ray couldn't do.
And had the look.
Yeah, and had a fantastic look. And he could make you look like you wanted to cheer him, or that like he was going to axe murder you.
He could be a top babyface, or he could be a top heel. He had the ability to do both.
Yeah, there is absolutely no excuse for why that man isn't a multi.
And how the fuck they're taking credit for Dolph Ziggler, I'll never know. Dolph Ziggler was already sent to the WWE and was a world tag team champion.
1/5.
While he was in OVW.
I'm still bearing spirits.
But they're so desperate to say, we've trained something down here. They're now taking the people that they raped from us when they fucked us over.
You mean when they pulled out like prom night?
Yeah.
I can't think of anybody other than...
And Sheamus is the only other person they can lay
in. Sheamus was over in Ireland, so they really can't claim him.
Well, if you get that down to it, they can't even claim him.
It'd be like us claiming Punk.
Because hadn't he been in Ireland for like 8 years?
Yeah, he'd been in Ireland for a long
and
time.
And Punk was with us, and I think Punk refined his game and picked up a little bit of the WWE knowledge from us.
But he
was established with ROH long before he got to us.
Yeah, I mean, so technically to me, FCW's produced fucking nothing.
And they're also claiming on this. Apparently, they're going to have this Summer Slammerama.
Well, I always wanted one of those.
And it's going
to. Hey, let me make it clear: I'm not bad mouthing anybody down at FCW because one of the guys there was part of what made OVW's training center great, and that was Pritchard.
Yeah,
Pritchard was one hell of a trainer, and they were stupid and fucking fired him because he didn't have a college degree.
Oh God!
That was Johnny Ace's fucking doing. Oh, well, you don't have a college degree, and you're going to have this, that, and the other. So they let him go and then realized they had one of the better trainers they'd ever had, and like a fool had to bring him back.
He was everybody here raved about his training.
Yeah.
He was the only person here that I think really ever delivered on that for the WWE classes.
Now what Kern does down in Florida, I don't know. I know Kern. I do not know him as a trainer.
Fabs.
I don't know what...
Steamboat
is there, and here's the weird thing. The last I'd heard on Steamboat is he damn near died of a brain aneurysm.
Killed Hashimoto.
And now he's down there, looked like he hadn't missed a fucking beat. Looking great, so I'm glad of that, but I did not know that he had recovered so well from his brain aneurysm.
Yeah, and speaking of Bruce Pritchard, he's not in FCW anymore.
Speaking of Bruce Pritchard, speaking of Tom Pritchard.
Yeah, Tom Pritchard, not Bruce. Okay.
Yeah, I was saying Bruce Pritchard, he just took over Terry Taylor's role in TNA.
Oh, for the love of God.
Well, Pritchard likes me, so I'm not going to say anything.
But apparently Terry...
Actually, speaking more about TNA in general, I mean...
Yeah, Terry Taylor was a known fuck-up everywhere he'd been, and on top of that was known for the sexual harassment lawsuits. He's gotten one everywhere he's been. So they shouldn't have been surprised. Pritchard, like I said, he's always been good to me, so I hate to say anything negative about him. But I don't know that Pritchard is what
Let's face it.
Let's face it. Nobody can help that situation. And people talk to, about me about, well, Kenny, why don't you go commentate down there? Well, what in the fuck would I want to do that for? Because nothing is going to help that situation. Not an announcer, not a booker. It would be a total overhaul before anything is going to fix that. You cannot plug an announcer here, a booker there, a writer over here.
You know, I used to say that
the whole thing is just fucked right now.
We used to say that Steve Austin or The Rock could save that company, but I think that it is so far gone.
Well, I said Steve Austin with his music, and The Rock wouldn't hurt to have his music.
I don't even mean by music. I just mean, you know, you give a talent. Sure, they can have their music, they can have their gimmick, whatever. Obviously, neither one would.
Yeah.
But I don't think that it would do anything at this point other than bury Austin and Rock.
Well,
Foley is buried from going there. Flair is buried from going there.
Yeah, Flair and Foley.
Angle is buried from going
the
there.
The three of them have no market value right now whatsoever. And as a matter of fact, Angle, I think, expressed interest in coming back to the WWE, and WWE didn't want him.
No, he's got that TNA stink on him.
Got that stink on him.
The only one who I think...
Ric Flair, I mean, only because he's a Hall of Famer, I think, would they ever do anything with him again.
He should have gone home when they sent him home.
And his reputation is so fucking shot.
No, he can't do anything now.
He's all but raped an orangutan in public, you know.
The only person who I could see surviving TNA right now is AJ.
Well... Yeah.
Jeff's done.
Yeah.
Matt's done.
Yeah, the Hardys are fucked.
They've slaughtered Samoa Joe.
Samoa's got no value at all, hardly, right now.
I used to worship the man, the ground that man.
I know. And same with Christopher Daniels.
And it is sad. Daniels, to me, is still hands down the best wrestler in the world, but what are you going to do with him?
Yeah.
The only person...
And WWE wouldn't know what to do with him.
No, they wouldn't.
They'd fuck it up.
And they wouldn't know what to do with AJ either, but I think AJ's good.
They would fuck AJ up. They would make him... Who was that little guy that was there talked with the country accent?
Oh,
come down here to
Gordy's
OVW
kid.
Three times. No, not Gordy's kid. Jamie Noble. Jamie Noble. AJ would become Jamie Noble Light.
Yeah, I could see that.
Is what they would do with him.
I could see that. Noble's a hell of a worker.
Yeah, he was. Yeah, he was.
But
so, WWE is...
Is there anybody else from TNA that could survive it? Because I can't think of anybody there.
Well,
Matt Morgan, possibly. They've already had him there with a stuttering gimmick.
Morgan,
and Matt's still young enough and fresh enough and hasn't been involved.
I'll give you that. They haven't done anything too stupid with Morgan.
Yeah.
Morgan, I think, would be okay. I forgot he was there.
Yeah. Well, I know I did, too, because they've done some fucking little with him. And I stated years ago, 3 or 4 years ago, that if I were going to start a wrestling company... Matt Morgan would be the first person to start it with.
Number one draft. Easily.
Number one. Out of non-established people that haven't already been established. I mean, obviously, if you can have Stone Cold, you know.
We're talking from the ground up,
people that have not made their mark in the business as of yet, Matt Morgan would be my first pick.
Yeah. Hernandez.
And they had him down there. They've had him, and they've fucked him up.
Hernandez is fucked.
Yeah, yeah.
All those Mexican-American guys. Sorry, Matt. I love you, but... Barella, I'm speaking of.
Yeah.
No, I can't think of a single person. You got anybody you think would survive it, Rob?
We don't often ask your opinion, but...
Awesome Kong has.
She got out a while ago, though. She was really out before the...
Well, and the jury is still out on that. She went to the WWE and walked to the ring a couple of times. And then had to go into a... They might have fucked her already.
Yeah.
Well, what happened with that?
She drops to her knees and cries, and I'm with child.
Is that what she said?
Yeah, I'm with child.
Oh, good God.
Oh, that line alone may have done her.
What the fuck?
Yeah, that line alone, I'm with child. I haven't heard that from anybody in my age group.
Love of God. Should she offer to shine my shoes?
No, Kong might be done. Now Prince. Remember the forum here.
I'm just saying. I mean, that's pretty... that's some archaic shit.
I know.
You don't go around with that.
So in other words, she's going to be off the market now for a full year, if not longer.
Beautiful people, I think that Velvet would survive.
I commented on that the other day that Angelina Jolie.
She's useless too. Angelina Love, yeah.
She was here at OVW for a day.
She's too scrawny.
She's too fucking skinny. She's got too many fucked up tattoos, and the tits do not match the cargo that's carrying it.
Velvet and Madison.
Nor the ass. I mean, if you're all tits, no body, and no ass. And somebody the other day stated, oh, it was Katie Lee. I did not know they were calling her Winner. I said, I posted on the wall, I wish I knew who the fuck Winner was so I could find out who this dumb fuck is that thinks Angelina Love is a great worker. Well, it turned out it's as an actually decent worker in Katie.
Yeah, Katie Lee.
Well, Katie's working a program with her, so what the fuck else is Katie going to say? Where else is she going to go? She's been let go from WWE because they didn't know what to do with her or Burchell. So they wanted to make them love.
Oh, yeah.
They wanted to make them love brother and sister. They wanted to have them doing each other before they decided to go PG-13. So they fucked both of them up. And now poor old Katie's down there who actually can work and does have some talent. And now she's forced to have to say that Angelina Love is a great worker. Angelina Love is better than she was when she was at OVW, but she was an OVW for a day, and Atlanta was about fed up with her. And when she got let go from WWE, she cried and begged Danny Davis for a cleaning job just to be able to hang around the boys so she could at least hang around and be a part of the group. She let me clean the building up. Let me do the bathrooms. That's how desperately she wanted to be around. And
well, that was a terrible sidetracking of our original point.
The reason I'm pointing all this out is that her head has gotten awfully fucking big. You know, she almost tries to big dog me on Facebook sometimes. And, you know, you don't get fired and come crawling to my boss begging for a job cleaning garbage cans and then act like you're a bigger fucking deal than me.
Because if there's one thing that's relevant in the world of professional wrestling, it's all of our Facebook interactions with
each other. Well, absolutely. Don't big dog me on Facebook if you haven't earned the right. Jarrett earned the right. Jarrett can big dog me if he wants.
And in the school of 12-year-old
Ox years, Baker can big dog me. But you know
Baker
what?
Have a fucking Facebook?
Yes, he certainly does. Oh, Douglas, Douglas Baker, he's on. Douglas Ox Baker, we communicate all the time.
I don't believe it.
Just because you ain't his friend, don't be fucking getting hot at me.
I'm upset that I'm not Ox Baker.
Well, apparently you should
be. He's my friend, too.
Oh, fuck you.
Yeah, maybe if you gave your left and right turn indicator when you're out on the highway.
Like a decent, normal human being.
Like a decent, normal human being.
Throwing blood.
Maybe Ox Baker, the kind man, would accept you as his friend.
That man makes a hell of a bowl of chili.
He does make a good bowl of chili. I was the judge at the Ox Baker chili cook-off up in Scranton, Michigan. Well, it wasn't there.
Where was it? Scranton, Michigan. It was in fucking where was Massachusetts.
Somewhere in Massachusetts, New Hampshire, Maine.
Yeah, somewhere in the vague northeast.
Somewhere in the deep north we were. What? For the record, it was not Scranton, Michigan. Vincennes, Indiana, or something. I don't know. It wasn't in Indiana.
I want to say that it was in
Nashua, New Hampshire. That's the town. And I was the special judge of the great chili cook-off, which chilies were being cooked by Ox Baker, Jason Wolfie Sanderson, the host, which you think I've been leaning that way. I think Greg the Hammer Valentine had a pot in there. I think Coco Beware had mixed up something out of Memphis. And
still pissing his son for taking that home run.
And Tito Santana, I think, had whipped up some Taco's Revenge or something.
I expected that to be better than it was.
And shockingly, I had voted Ox Baker as the best chili.
Well, he threatened to make you number four.
Yeah, yeah. And he said if I didn't vote him the winner, that I was going to be the fourth man he killed in the ring. And I could not risk that. So I was just saving my own life.
So now that we've gotten all the Facebook feuding and the Ox Baker reminiscing out of the
way. I don't know that we've gotten it all out of the way, but
Rob, who do you think could survive leaving TNA?
Oh, let's see here. I think Madison Rayne could.
Yeah, I'll give you Rayne and
y'all a little higher on Rayne than I am.
Good looking girl, decent worker. I got no problem.
Good looking girl. I think Velvet's the class of that bunch, though.
Yeah, I'll give you that. But
I wish she didn't have that big ass tramp stamp.
I could give less than a rat's ass about who has.
Well, I don't want anybody to have tattoos. Well, if you're beautiful, don't mar yourself up.
Well, tattoos are older than not having tattoos. So there you go.
Look at me. Have you ever seen me put a tattoo on this beautiful body of mine?
You weigh 500 pounds.
The bigger this body gets, I've never weighed 500 pounds, mind you.
Fine, 523. I don't.
I've never weighed 523, mind you.
I'll give you Rayne. Who else you got?
You're very insulting this week, Prince.
I could probably go with Kazarian. Or Beer Money.
I'd like to go with you because I think he's a good talent.
I like the look Like the attitude, but WWE would fuck him up.
I don't think he has enough of a promo to get himself over.
Well, no, he was in the WWE.
He's a little shy there. WWE would not be able to make him a big star, I can assure you. He's almost better off there with the semblance of people that he's with.
I liked him as a heel with AJ.
And we could get the fans to eat him up at OVW. But then again, we're talking.
He was here once. Him and Kid Cash had a really good match.
Damn, they did, didn't they? They sure did. Yeah. You're right. I forgot about that.
That was a damn good match.
And but no, WWE would not know how to fucking get him over. They would fuck that up with that. You got to remember, I've had a pretty much a 15-year relationship either with WWE or with them real close to me, and I know what they can do and what they can't, and they would fuck that up.
I wish they wouldn't, because he's a damn good worker.
Well, it is a shame.
If you can remember, Kazarian was in the WWE for a short time.
Yeah, a cup of coffee, and they didn't do
well, much. Obviously they didn't do much, because I don't remember him being there. What did he do?
Velocity.
Well, okay. Well, goddamn, Rob, your memory's a lot better than mine, but that ain't saying dick.
I remember.
Yeah, he was there for a very, very, very short time, and then
he quit.
Yeah,
he quit?
He didn't. They wanted him to cut his hair. He said, fuck you.
Uh-huh.
Because at the time he had really long hair, he said, nope.
Yep. And whatever. That tells you right there, because I've had people argue with me when I find out what the guy's real salaries are.
Yeah.
And what they're really bringing home after they have to cut out for taxes.
Yeah.
And after they take out their transportation money and reimbursements and all this. No one believes me. There are some guys up there working that are profiting less than $350 to $400 a week.
Yeah.
And nobody wants to believe me. Oh, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. Well, I do know, because I hear they tell me, and their wives who manage the books tell me.
By the time you finish your gym memberships in each individual town.
Yeah.
Because WWE don't pay for
any of that shit.
Tanning, food, hotels for the lower card guys.
Yeah.
Rent-a-cars, because they don't cover that shit.
No, they don't cover the rent-a-cars.
I mean, yeah, that shit stacks.
And if you upgrade anything on your flight, not only do you got to pay for it, but you get heat for it as well.
Yeah, I was going to say, remember one of the main things Christian left for that first time was because they were giving him shit over upgrading to first class.
Yeah, yeah.
Motherfucker was one of the top draws they had. The crowd wanted him to beat Batista so goddamn bad that night.
I know.
And they were pissed that he wanted a first class ticket that he was paying for himself.
Yeah, to me, if you want to pay for your fucking first class ticket, ride fucking first class. And no more people than the WWE has, and I've said it before on the old bowling alley, shame on Vince, shame on the whole fucking company, because I would not want any of my wrestlers to be seeing riding coach.
Except Foley.
When I hear Joey Behar and all these cunts over at The View, which I do watch every day, by the way.
Yeah, I was going to say, why are you giving The View shit? You T-Bolt religiously.
Well, I'm not giving it shit. I'm just saying that they have a tendency to be a bunch of worthless cunts, is what I'm saying. But they all fly first class. There's five of them. Okay, whatever. But if you're portraying your industry as stars, and you don't let them work anywhere else anyway, so they're not independent contractors. We've had this argument before.
We have.
Give them decent benefits other than when they get hurt in the ring. Give them a decent livable salary from your bottom guys on up, because it takes the whole roster to form a show. It's Barnum and Bailey. Just because the one guy, the big top guy, has the hardest gig, well, everybody else gets paid pretty good too.
Well, from what I remember, a lot of main event matches in the 90s, they didn't have the hardest gig. I mean, if you look back at WCW...
Well, no, the bottom card working harder than they are.
I was going to say, you remember those old WCW Nitros and pay-per-views?
And you know what? Fuck Hogan and fuck Andre the Giant.
Oh, yeah. I'll go there.
God damn them. They're acting like that was the greatest fucking match ever. No. Two big lazy fucks.
And if you watch that match, they didn't...
Sorry, Andre, but you didn't work that fucking hard the last 15 years of your career.
And he was near death in that match.
Exactly. That's why it ended the way that it ended.
Which Mania was that? What was the undercard?
Three, I think.
Was that three?
I think it was three.
I thought Warrior was three.
Well, it could be. I don't know.
Because Savage Steamboat
I'm just
was
mad. I'm just in a bad mood.
Savage
tonight.
Steamboat was three.
When I'm saying fuck Andre, you know I'm in a bad mood. No. But don't act like that's a great fucking match.
No, it was an awful match.
Big fucks.
Anybody who watches that to learn something, just please stay the fuck out of OVW. I will run you out of the locker room.
Well, you learn to not be a combined weight of 900 pounds and get in the ring. That's what you learned.
combined hairline of a 93-year-old man in that
Jesus
match.
Christ. Rob, you wasn't expecting all his anger tonight, were you?
Well, speaking
fuck of Andre. No one says fuck Andre, and I just said it tonight.
Well, you know what? I ain't going
to do dick about it. I have every confidence of that.
I still think during that time.
And if that big motherfucker digs up out of a hole, I will learn to run again, I promise you.
I still think during that time that Kamala was the biggest heel in that company.
The Ubangi giant?
Yep.
The Uganda giant, the biggest heel. Name me the top heels there, because I'm having a...
Was Stud around at that time?
I'm having a little trouble getting...
Well,
like
it was...
Big giant,
you got to remember that the biggest heels at the time...
No, Kamala's still with us.
The biggest heels at the time... I can't leave out the Honky Tonk Man.
Honky Tonk had real fucking heat.
I was going to say, Honky's biggest heel if Honky's around. I mean, there's no questioning that.
Yeah, Honky had the real fucking heat. It wasn't intended to be that way. They wanted him to be a babyface.
I got
to
take this real quick.
He's told the story a few times. Prince has been an important man here. you solo for a second. Prince had an important phone call.
No problem. I still think that...
I liked the Ugandan giant gimmick, but you got to remember, I saw it in Memphis to where it really fucking meant something. Because there, he was a big fucking freak and was not a cartoon character. And I felt what the WWE got a hold of was a little bit of a cartoon character.
Well, I think really what got him over as a heel at the time was Kimchi. And that in the WWE.
I wasn't that fond of the manager that was with him. I really wasn't.
I'm not. I think that's the reason.
Like I said, I'm going by memory here, and I'm trying to think of others that were from that era. And he did all right. I don't know if I'd label him the guy with the biggest heat or not. I don't think I'd go there. Well, but then again, I'm having trouble remembering who all the heels were at that time.
And the only reason I say he...
And obviously, I'd have to put Honky Tonk Man over Kamala.
Because, well, the Honky Tonk Man came a little bit after Kamala, believe it or not.
Well, that's kind of the way I remember it, too. But my memory fades so much now, it's not...
My real long-term
memory's good, but apparently that ain't long enough for me.
Because what I remember when I first started watching wrestling, which was... 85, 86. God, I was 3 or 4 years old.
I started in 65, and 66 is when I started watching.
And at the time...
are you still with me?
I'm still with you. Sorry about that. At the time, it was Kamala that was facing a lot of the big guys, and he was the heel at the time. So...
Okay, we're hearing a little breakup on your end, Rob. I don't know how you're all hearing me, but I'm hearing some breakup on your end.
Okay, I think we've got it.
There you go. You sound better now.
All right, so what was the argument here for the Ugandan?
He was the best heel of that era. He thinks Honky Tonk Man was a little after. I think I'd have to agree with him.
You mean after chronologically or after heat-wise?
No, chronologically.
Honky came a little bit after.
You're still cutting out, and no. Honky was the biggest heel of his era, hands down, but who would have been in that WrestleMania 3 era? Would that have been DiBiase?
I want to believe so. Or
DiBiase
Piper.
Had to have been around some then. DiBiase was a hell of a fucking heel.
DiBiase,
Piper.
Piper, yeah. I don't know. I like Kamala, especially as...
I just like Memphis Kamala better than WWE
Kamala. Memphis
Kamala
was vile and evil.
Yeah,
he wanted to kill you. WWE Kamala was a belly slap.
And it's easier to scare them Mason-Dixon line fans than it is those Northern Prince.
Yeah. Well, this is a horrible portrayal of Aberdeen. Yeah, no. Yeah. Who else did we have up there who were heels of that WrestleMania 3 time period? Everybody likes Savage, so I'm not going to count him.
Was Jake Roberts a heel at the time?
I think he was pretty close to that era.
To me, Jake Roberts was too intellectual to be a good heel.
And I'm pretty sure Jake Roberts and Honky Tonk worked a few angles, didn't they?
Well, yeah. Believe it or not, I think it was Jake Roberts that got over, that put Honky Tonk Man over quite a bit.
That's what I thought.
I'm going to look up the card to WrestleMania 3 on my trusty Droid X. We're going to settle this.
Any other questions? We've been on with you now. I don't know how long here. What are we showing?
Well, we've
44
got about,
minutes. What other questions you got for us?
Well, we've got a decent amount. I threw you know, I've thrown a couple down here.
That's all right.
One that I had that kind of stuck out at me was Christian. He actually won the World Heavyweight Championship at the pay-per-view.
For a day or two.
Yeah, it was a day or two, and then lost it to Randy Orton on SmackDown.
Yeah, so, I thought that was a crock of shit. I thought it was a big slap in the face to Christian. And if they wanted to put it on Randy, put it on Randy. Don't fucking insult Christian in the process. I think it was done as a favor for Edge, but, you know, give him a bit of a run with it. Give him 30 days, give him 60, 90 days, you know, and then if Randy, I mean, Randy don't need the belt. It wasn't going to hurt Christian to have it.
Right.
And because they have not really just done that much of a meaningful thing with Christian since he's been back anyway. And I think Christian could have used it and deserved it better than a lot of others.
Definitely.
So, no, I thought it was a slap in the face. If I'd have known that's what they were going to do and I were his manager, I'd have told him to shove it up their ass.
Definitely.
You're going to put it on him and you're going to what? No, you ain't. Fuck you. Put it on Randy that night. Fuck you. You know, if that's all you think of Christian and the work and the dedication he's given you.
Because he is a damn solid worker who always gets people over. He's always been over with the crowd. I personally don't understand it. Iron Sheik was around in that era. Honky Tonk Man was around in that era. Jake Roberts was a face in that era. Savage was around in that era.
Was Rick Rude?
Rick Rude.
Yeah, he was solid.
He's not on this list, so he may not have come up yet.
He was close, though. He was right around there.
And I'd say Rick Rude was probably a better heel than Kamala in WWE. The Kamala from Japan and the Kamala from Memphis was main event level heel. The Kamala that was in WWE was just too cartoony. He was like everything else they did.
Yeah, that was mine.
I mean, all the belly slapping and the looks, it was too gimmicky.
And he liked the manager, and I wasn't much on Kenshi or whatever.
The beekeeper guy, yeah. Kenshi, yeah. I
wasn't that much on him.
Which is actually a Korean dish, which makes no sense to me at all.
Right.
All right, so we proved you wrong on Kamala. What else you got?
We like Kamala, just not in the same context.
Maybe just not as much as you do.
Well, I remember Kamala. He was in the WWE before Honky Tonk Man. So
yes.
I'm remembering him before he came back and he started doing the belly slapping and had kimchi, and I think really to me what got him over after his first run in the WWE was the kimchi part, but not necessarily in a good sense.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Well, it was a different product at that time.
Yep.
And what other questions you got for us?
Okay, well, there was another you guys are going to have a heyday on this one.
Dying to hear it.
Shane Helms was in a drunk motorcycle wreck.
Get out of here.
And he damn near broke his girlfriend's neck.
Yeah, I remember hearing a little bit about that. And the sad thing is that Shane Helms... Christopher not only was a fan of his coming up, but we actually got to be decent friends with him there for a while he was here. He'd even ask about my son when he's in town, so it's kind of hard to go real negative on him. But when you're drunk driving and on a fucking motorcycle...
It seems like that whole Omega crew has let their lives go to shit, though. I mean, they all do that shit. Jeff does it, Matt does it, Joey Matthews had his problems, Shane Helms has had his... Nobody was a bigger Shane Helms mark in WCW days than I was. I thought he was fucking fantastic.
Yeah.
The Vertebreaker still is
and
my favorite.
And a nice
guy,
and I like him too, but that does not excuse stupidity.
No, and I'm all for somebody being personally stupid. Hurt yourself till you're blue in the face, please. I do not care. But don't endanger somebody else for your stupidity.
Yeah. It's with him, and what the fuck was his girlfriend thinking if she knew he was drunk and got on a motorcycle with him?
I mean, were they wearing helmets, or do we know?
I don't know. I saw a hospital picture of him, and she's in a neck brace, and his face is all fucked up.
Oh, shit.
Like I said, I like him as a person, and I think he's a fantastic worker, but I think the hurricane ruined him. I think it was one of those short-term solutions that just got out of hand.
Well, it was the version of the Spirit Squad.
Yeah, it was. It shouldn't have gotten over. It got over fantastically, and then he could never go back to being Sugar Shane Helms.
Yeah, and then they put Molly Holly in it with him.
Yeah.
It did her a big favor.
And that was the whole downside with him, because he was a great worker. He could have made that Cruiserweight division matter there. Him and Chavo had fantastic matches in WCW.
But they never did it. They never let him have that freedom to actually work. They took away his finish. Nobody's ever been hurt from the Vertebraker that I know. I think
it was a wicked-looking move. I know I didn't want it on me. It was a scary-looking move.
Oh, yeah, I don't... It's menacing, but... It's a Japanese women's finish, actually.
But no, it's a shame. I mean, I consider him a friend. I've never had nothing but good words for him, but that was very fucking stupid, and I just hope he's learned a lesson and doesn't do anything that stupid again, and damn near took his girlfriend's life right along with his.
Yeah. I certainly think that he was better than Shannon Moore.
Yeah, I'd give you that. Shannon Moore, even in his freaked out little shit that he does, if I knew any adult man that ever ran from Shannon Moore, I'd have him locked up.
Oh yeah, no, never. On Pride.
I don't even take him remotely seriously, but apparently he takes himself very seriously.
And who would have ever thought that out of three count, the World Heavyweight Champion would have been Evan Courageous?
Not me.
Former AWA champion.
No, Shannon Moore, I'm sorry, he just... If I saw him in the back, I'd say, hey, kid, you know, if somebody gets hurt, if we're low on bodies tonight, I'll see if I can get you in there. I know there's going to be some people disagree with me. Not very many, but there might be a handful out there that disagree with me. But
they're those guys who are marks for the Hardys and all their guys, and they defend that crew to the fucking
head. Yeah, yeah.
And I don't get it. None of them are really that good except Shane. Shane was the best one there, and he never really got anything other.
My dose of the Hardy Boys goes with the Hardy Boys, and...
Jeff and Taker had that great match.
And they're not sober. They're not sober enough to do anything good anymore anyway.
There was that Jeff-Taker title match on Raw, the ladder match.
Yeah, well, that was good.
That was a fantastic match. Anybody wants to see Jeff Hardy work, watch that and then stop.
Yep, that's about where it'll end at.
Yeah. What else you got for us?
We're going to take a turn to TNA.
Well, good luck. We don't know all that much about it, but we'll give an opinion.
Okay, well, we...
Alex Shelley for the win.
Well, we're not going to talk about Alex Shelley, but you...
Well, fuck you. He's the only thing there we're talking about.
True. But Chyna, I guess, made her TNA debut.
I did see that. I did see that.
And to her credit...
I TiVo'd a little bit of it, and I saw her come out and not speak a word and really fuck up the part she was in, so I did see that.
And
how'd she look?
Well, she looked... better than I'd seen her look. I'll give her that. You know, but
that was a cop out.
She never said a word. Well, I guess it was. She never said a word, and they even had a backstage interview with her where she didn't say a word.
That's hard to do.
Yeah, yeah. And like I said, physically, she looked about as good as I've seen her look. She looked better than I've seen her in some of these reality shows I've seen her in. But she looked like she had never been in a wrestling ring. That's what I saw when she got in to do her bit. Her timing was way off, and she looked like she had never been in a wrestling ring. It was not that presence that she had when she was going to whip Jarrett's ass in the WWE.
I mean, I forgot they had a feud. That's what that whole thing was about. I was wondering what the business was there. It's like, why Chyna?
Yeah, yeah.
Now
you understand why I forgot Turk got thrown through a television by who?
By the Moose. I mean,
yeah, well, I forgot.
It's part of the crew. All right.
Neither one of them were BS, so I had no reason to remember it.
And apparently she is she got released from TNA. Because
what? You're cutting out again.
Okay. Sorry. She got released from TNA because she's going back to doing porn.
All I can say is the motherfucker who wants to gaze his eyes upon her nude is a sick motherfucker.
Actually, I got a text this morning at around 8 a.m.
Prince must know somebody that wants to see her name.
Hang on. He restated what he said for quotability. Let me get down here to it.
All right.
From my friend Jeremy, one of my fellow Aspies. He said, "Shemale porn is somehow less gay. It's just wrong. Your gut is telling you no, but curiosity has its hand on your cock and it won't let go."
That was
what I woke up to at 8:30 this morning from my friend Jeremy discussing his experience with a backdoor into Chyna.
Oh, no. No, I got no desire to see Chyna. I don't want to see Chyna with clothes on, more or less off.
Yeah, I don't know.
No desire. Triple H can have all that image he wants.
Waltman.
Well, Triple H had her first.
Which is really bad because
he had the freaky challenge.
Yeah, he had the one with the chin.
He had Jay Leno challenge.
Yeah, yeah. I was trying to think of Jay Leno.
Yeah, how in the hell do you get Jay Leno China and be happy with that? So I can't blame him for going for Steph.
No, definitely an upgrade. Definitely an upgrade. I don't think anybody can fault the game for that.
But God, is that as good as he could get? Was China?
Well, he did have a big nose.
Well, he did have a big nose. She had a big chin. I guess creatively, they might have been going for some type of freakish little monster.
He had
as a
prolific
baby.
Proboscis, if you get right into it.
Yeah.
All right, what do you got?
Mick Foley.
China naked makes us sick. There you go.
Mick Foley has requested and granted his release from TNA.
I love Mick. Fantastic guy. Fantastic ambassador for the business, but he killed his career by going there, plain and simple.
Yeah, so he asked for his release, huh?
Yeah, apparently they were having disagreements on the direction of the company.
The only thing that I can be sad about is that it took him this long to realize that they were going in different directions.
I mean, by at this point, I keep expecting Fred Durst to win the heavyweight.
Unless he needed the check, I don't know. And I would think that Mick ought to have a little bit of cash saved by now, but
Mick could have sat around in Connecticut making money for the rest of his life. He got bitter about the commentary thing, and it's stupid. He didn't need to go there, and it cheapened who Mick Foley was.
Well, I agree with him. I don't want anybody telling me or Mick or Jerry Lawler Booker T. You can tell him what to say, but who knows if he said it anyway. And I did make it clear today. Someone asked me what my opinion was on R-Truth. I don't recall where that question came from.
Poor man's Booker T.
But someone wanted to know what I thought of R-Truth, and I said, well, I think I stated better heel than a babyface. I think I put that on my wall, right?
Yeah, you did.
And I also said, please God, don't ever let Booker T interview R-Truth, because who the fuck's going to translate that?
Oh, good God.
Who's going to translate the translator?
In all fairness, I like the book.
But then again, I'd like to see that interview just for the humor of it.
Only if you can have Kurt Hennig be the guy that comes up after.
Great googly moogly.
What?
who was that wrestler you said
Ahmed
that about?
Ahmed Johnson.
If Ahmed Johnson interviewed Booker T interviewing R-Truth, that could be one of the greatest things ever put on film.
With Dusty Rhodes. It's your
With Dusty guest. Rhodes as a special guest translator of the translators. That'd be some good shit. All right, somebody book that.
There we go. And I don't know if you catch Eric Bischoff's rants online ever on his Facebook.
The only thing I heard is that he was bitching a little bit about how ROH is not competition, and
well,
he should know what not competition is.
Yeah. He continues to rant on what he calls the 10%ers, which is
Who are the 10%ers? I'm dying to hear this.
These are the internet wrestling community. He continues to rant on them.
Oh, there's only 10% of the wrestling community that's on the internet, huh?
Yeah, apparently that's what he thinks.
I got news for the dumbass. It's 10% that aren't on.
Actually, I like
I like Bish too.
My thing is that
if he thinks that only 10% of the wrestling community is on the internet,
if he's talking about WWE's audience, which is mostly made up of kids and women, yeah, that's fair.
Nah,
it's probably close to 30%.
It's still more than 10, yeah.
I mean, I'd go 30 on a WWE audience. But for his audience, no. It is 100% internet marks.
Yeah.
Nobody else has the patience to try to figure out what the fuck TNA is doing, except for guys that really want to see Joe, that really want to see Daniels, that really want to see AJ, and that keep hoping to God that Ric Flair is going to pull his career out of his ass.
Or that think Angelina Love has talent.
Marianne tried to give me that argument, and I wasn't buying it then.
Oh, well, who the fuck is Marianne to fucking try and judge talent anywhere?
I like Marianne, but no.
I mean, that's like me going to a NASCAR event trying to tell the guys how to drive their cars.
In a circle?
Well, I guess I could tell them.
I don't get NASCAR.
Now that I think about it, I guess I could tell them. Four left turns, boys. Keep hooking it. And go fast. So I think we got that figured out.
And,
fantastic sport until Car of Tomorrow kicked in, then it sucked. And why does the Car of Tomorrow have a carburetor on it? It's the car of the future. You would think that they could manage electronic fuel injection.
You would think.
Sorry, that's a bit of a pet peeve of mine.
All right. What's next?
Apparently, and what he keeps ranting about is that he's saying that TNA has grown under his watch.
What, cancer?
I was going to say a tumor.
I wanted to kind of throw these numbers out at you.
Yeah, throw them out. I'm dying to see what he's basing this on.
So is TNI.
So here's the numbers from November 2009. This is, I guess, close to the same time that they, right before that they came on, maybe. I'm not.
Yeah, they came in January 2010.
Okay, so November 2009, they had a, you know, throughout the 4 weeks, they had a rating of 1.07, 1.14, 1.12, and 0.91.
Hey, now, do you do remember what Hogan guaranteed they would get when they came out?
3.0s on a Monday.
Yep. 3.0s is what we're going to be getting as soon as Hogan
against
gets there.
WWE.
Yeah, going head-to-head.
And here we come. We come to May 2010, and the first Monday show that they had.
Now, if memory serves me correctly, the highest rating they've ever got, if memory serves me correctly, was either a 1.67 or lower.
I thought it was 1.22.
No, it's higher than 1.22.
And
here we go. We're about to find out, I guess.
May 2010, their first Monday show ever, they scored a 0.69 rating.
Was that the head-to-head show?
That was the head-to-head show.
I recall that, a 0.69. That was beautiful.
They got massacred.
That's just lovely, the way they did that, the way they had all their viewers not watch the show no more. That was just genius. That was genius.
You'll have to forgive his love of Atros Perot. It kicks in at the most odd times.
That's just masterful how they did that.
I think that we should point out that this house is very avid in support of Atros Perot.
Well, we love Atros Perot.
We believe that he should have been president. This isn't pro wrestling.
Now, a lot of people thought they was going for more viewers, but they weren't. They was going for about half. And if that was what they was going for, it was just genius. Because they got about half the viewers they were getting. And that's just masterful booking right there.
And indeed, he should have been president. He would have been president.
See, some people thought they was going to double their audience. They was just going for half.
Well, I guess I'll have to put over Atros Perot on another edition of the Alley, because you're just not going to let it happen today.
Oh, God.
I just want another viable third-party candidate, Rob. That's all that I want.
Just third-party.
There's never going to be another Teddy Roosevelt, and the closest thing to it was Atros, and he fucked it up, so...
Well, what about Ron Paul?
Fuck Ron Paul. Fuck Ralph Nader. No, they're not viable.
And by the way, before we get off on Ron Paul and Ron Nader, or Ralph Nader, the wiener guy who likes to show his penis to various women, what was the highest rating TNA ever scored?
Well, from what I'm seeing here, the highest that they've got written down here is a 1.27.
Oh. Really? Was that it? They never did crack a 1.6? I thought they did.
They may have last year sometime, but nothing this year.
Okay, all right. Well, if it didn't happen last year, it might not have happened.
Because as of...
I thought it was early on that they did crack a 1.6. Maybe that was for a quarter hour, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, the highest they scored during that month of May in 2010 was a 0.96.
And, ouch. Going by Price is Right rules, which we always do. Yeah. I won that.
How's that?
I was close without going over.
Well, you didn't go over. I would have went over.
Yeah, Price is Right.
Well, I watched the Price is Right today for the first time in God knows when. Both contestants went over. So, yeah, you can't go over.
No, beat you by the Bob Barker standard.
And there stood Drew Carey looking like he had his dick in his hand because he had no prizes to give away.
Sad.
Sad.
Very sad.
I cried. No prizes.
May, and then May 2011.
Was the merchandise on stage, and nobody got none of it.
You're cutting out, and we're putting over Bob Barker, so.
All right.
No, over Drew Carey. Mm. Quit making that noise, because the microphone picks it up. Don't you know anything about mathematics?
No.
Don't you know anything about audio engineering?
No.
All right, well, that shows.
It's acoustical engineering, but okay, whatever. All right, what were you saying, Rob?
May 2011 this year.
By the way, our webcam is laying on a Foghorn Leghorn DVD for everybody that wants to get that image in their head.
We do love Foghorn Leghorn. In the
I ain't saying anything.
I'm not a pumpkin. Sorry, Rob. What were you saying?
May 2011 of this year, they scored a 1.5, a 1.27, a 1.17, and a 1.2.
They did get a 1.5, huh?
No, they did not.
They didn't. Yeah,
1.15.
Oh, 1.5, you said.
No, 1.15.
Oh, my bad.
I'm
still over then.
From May 2009, when they didn't have Hogan and Bischoff.
Maybe I meant two shows, 2 weeks in a row added up to a 1.6.
You know, and I'm going to put Bischoff over for this because it's a fair point. Bischoff wanted to reduce the number of house shows, which is a good business plan for them, and he wanted to reduce the number of pay-per-views.
Yeah.
I support both of those ideas.
WWE should do the same thing.
There's at least still draw. I mean, they should, just to make the big four mean more, but I think they've maxed out what they're going to get, so there's no point in reducing. They'd be losing revenue. I think it would help the product overall, but they'd be losing money.
You don't think the big four would just be huger draws if they did away with all the crap?
No, because I think that as many people are interested are going to buy them as ever would.
Yeah.
But I firmly believe that if they would actually have done what Bischoff said and reduce the house shows, reduce the pay-per-views, and actually put on a decent Thursday show, which they haven't even attempted, that they would have been much more competitive in the long run. It would have been a longer-term plan. It would have been profitable instantly, but it would have worked. And I support the Bish for saying that, and I'm sad. I'm very sad that they wouldn't actually do it.
Gotcha. And then, you know, we're kind of on the Bischoff topic here, but, you know, the next person in line here is Hulk Hogan. And apparently he – I don't know if you heard this or not, but he made a remark on his Facebook account. And,
oh, Hogan has a Facebook account?
Yeah, apparently he's got a Facebook – well, he's got Twitter because he blocked me on Twitter, so
– He blocked you on Twitter?
Well, he blocked me on Twitter because I asked Bubba the Love Sponge how Hogan's cock tastes.
Ooh! Good old Hogan.
And so they both blocked me.
All right.
But
send me the link. I'll see if he'll accept me. Lord knows I've never said anything bad about Hulk Hogan.
This is what went on his Facebook account. He said... All right.
I know he's been feuding with Warrior. I've been hearing that.
Well, that's another topic that I'm going to get to in a minute. But apparently somebody had sent him a message on Facebook or Twitter, and he answered this person and said, "That's good to know, brother, but in reality, it was a lot of you idiot fans that killed WCW with your lack of appreciation and support for everything we did for you. Funny enough, a lot of you morons like TNA, too. Go figure." This is what he said. To his own fans, that they killed WCW.
That's somebody that needs a fucking reality check, is all I can tell you.
And apparently...
The fans will support good wrestling.
And that was my kind of thought when reading that.
If normally, if your program is getting buried by the fans, there's a reason for it.
Right.
OVW is not putting out a good product, it takes a hit, and we've had our times that we've done that. Things have gotten better lately. The crowds are up. Go figure. Then sometimes there's times you can't fuck it up, like WWE. They have done everything they can to fuck it up and couldn't do it for a great period of time. TNA was in the, not TNA, but WCW was in the same boat there for a while. NBA. Didn't matter what they did, they were going to win the ratings no matter what.
Playoffs killed them.
And then the NBA playoffs came, and people got a dose of what the WWE was doing in that new attitude era, and that was when it all changed.
And then,
the main event guys in WCW never did shit to get it over. I mean, the NWO got everything started, but what kept people watching was the Rey Mysterios, the Chris Jerichos, the Malinkos. Though they had an incredible mid-card at that point. Conan, Juventud, Liger, Chono coming over, Tenzan, Nagata, the Torimon guys coming up and working spot matches. I mean, that's what made everybody care about WCW. You cared because of the Lucha guys.
And by the way, what's strange now, New Attitude got over on the WCW, and the New Attitude won out. Well, now, here at WWE's back to PG-13 again, and TNA would be your New Attitude. They bleed, they cuss, they got tits and ass. But now that's losing out.
But it's because it isn't being done in an interesting way.
Well, exactly. Exactly.
I mean, I can go watch a Piranha death match if I want, but if it's not interesting, why would I care?
Yeah.
Well, and you know, TNA's got this new catchphrase called Wrestling Matters.
Yeah, how much time did they spend on wrestling last show? I think I heard...
How much of the wrestling minutes gone up on the show in the last couple of weeks?
22 minutes out of a two-hour show? Is that what I heard?
I always say when wrestling matters is when you'll get more than three matches a two-hour program.
Is TNA 2 hours?
TNA is 2 hours long, and they have about maybe 3 to 4 matches at max.
God damn, who watches that?
Well, I don't know.
Well, they started off, listen to this, they started off the last episode of it with ODB and Velvet Sky brawling.
ODB's back?
ODB's back, yep.
10 pounds heavier. Well,
and,
maybe not.
And, well, and she's playing a heel, so.
Yeah?
So, we'll see.
Well, ODB did a good job up here. My only complaint about ODB is she got a little carried away with the tattoos, but everybody knows I hate tattoos, so. I think they're disgusting.
So, back on the Hogan thing, apparently what happened was he then said somebody hacked his account.
Well, that happens. Remember that guy that showed his dick on the internet, that Congressman Wiener? Congressman Wiener showed his wiener on the internet, said his account got hacked, and then apparently got the pressure put on him because six other girls were also getting pictures of his wiener. And then he had to do a big press conference today stating that he had lied. Go figure. I called him a liar the minute he said it.
Well, and then...
I'm as famous as he is. Ain't nobody hacked my account.
And then the honky-tonk man had something to say about it.
What honky-tonk say?
Honky-tonk said, laughing out loud, Hogan trying to say he didn't make the WCW post and blame some Photoshop fan. He said, it was there, Hogan, and made from your account. Yes, it was on his page from his cell application, just like all of his other tweets, then deleted it. So.
No, that's all horse shit. God damn, if something comes from your account, you made it. Fucking own up to it. Be a man. Hogan.
In the immortal words of Randy Savage, be a man, Hogan.
Jesus Christ, Hogan. I know you're listening. Jesus freaking Christ. Just own up that you said it. Was it right what you said? You know you're fucking wrong. The fans make the decision. We give them good shit, they buy a ticket and come and see it. They don't, they shit on us. That's entertainment in general. That's Charlie Sheen. That's fucking...
The David Arquette title win.
Yeah, yeah, you gave him that, you dickhead. Shut up.
Was he still around when they did that?
Sure he was. I guess he was.
You know, Canyon never really got his due.
Canyon?
Chris Canyon?
No, you're not. Whoa. Not going to either.
No, but I mean, it's kind of upsetting. He's a damn solid worker.
We're an hour and 11 minutes in. Let's see if we can wrap this up in about 4 to 5 minutes here. Give him about an hour and 15 this
What
time.
Else you got for us?
Means we've been
okay.
Down a while.
Let's see. We were talking about the Ultimate Warrior YouTube videos towards Hulk Hogan.
I love Jim Hellwig and all of his fucking mind-numbing insanity.
I thought they were fake because that was the most coherent I've ever seen him in 25 years. So
you're saying that if it was coherent, somebody had to write it for
someone
him?
Someone had to have written it and actually even performed it for him, possibly a look-alike.
So you're saying that the Renegade is not cutting promos on Hulk Hogan?
Right. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Isn't the Renegade dead?
I think so.
Yeah.
But it could be him, though.
Yeah. They dug him up. Fuck.
Yeah.
Are we loyal to the Renegade? Can we make dead jokes about him?
I think we're... Yeah. 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 Right. Yeah. Renegade's cool.
All right. Just making sure. I don't want to piss anybody off.
No, I don't want to piss anybody off.
Idol was a big Renegade, Mark. We were watching him on AWA, and he popped up there. Can't remember what he was doing.
James Arness died. Matt Dillon. And a lot of us having trouble dealing with that.
I can't talk about that yet. It's too early. It's too
Matt
soon.
Matt fucking Dillon, Gunsmoke. Anyone's got anyone says anything bad about James Arness, they're gonna fucking fight me in the street. And the Prince.
Yes.
He ain't happy about it either.
No, I'm not. I can't talk about it yet. I'm
the only man to pull that every week got shot at. Every week they shot first, but every week he killed them instead. We figure he must have killed about 8,000 people in 22 years.
I think that all of BS should wear Stetsons tomorrow. And
if I could find them, I would. We would all wear them. And in honor of James Arness, Matt Dillon. And Kevorkian died, and I heard Cornette was upset about that, because now that Jimmy's locked into ROH, he's probably going to be looking for a visit from Kevorkian soon, and now there's nobody to help him. He's on his own.
Grizz goes to a Dr. Kevorkian.
Does he really?
Yeah, his doctor is a Kevorkian.
Doctor, yeah, that's a popular name in the doctor business.
I'd go, just see what happens.
Well, you might not see what happens.
Well.
Go see Dr. Kevorkian. But yeah, Arness, I think, was 88, and Kevorkian was 84, so, you know.
But back to the Warrior thing, I mean, in all fairness, what Hogan says about Warrior... Probably true.
Well, yeah.
He is a fucking raging lunatic.
And what Warrior says about Hogan.
Probably true.
Probably true.
He is a bastard.
That's where shoot interviews come from, when both parties and what they say are true.
But I would rather listen to Warrior, because he's much more fun.
Cornette and I say a lot of bad things about each other.
Are we ever going to post that shit I got on my phone?
Unfortunately, we're going to save that. It could come. You know, we'll see if we need it.
Actually, you know, we should request an outpouring of support to actually get it posted.
Well, we got some stuff y'all would like to see, but... Well, the Prince does. I don't have it. The Prince has it.
There we go.
We'll talk about that maybe on the Super Show.
On the Super
Show. Let him know what we've got. And
try to blackmail him?
Blackmail him or something. Maybe get some cash out of him.
So,
we got anything else there, partner?
We do. We got one more. We got a couple more things here on the list, and
two more things before we go.
Sean Waltman has made confessions that he, as a preteen, was molested.
Couldn't happen to a nicer guy.
Well, there's a shock.
And that was picked up by TMZ, by the way.
TMZ got that, yep. And he was molested as a teen. Huh?
Well, as a preteen.
Does he say who molested him?
Apparently it was both a female and male that did it.
Well, number one, a teenager cannot be molested by a female. That can't be done. When I was 12 years old, I was begging adult women to have their way with me. So, fuck that. I ain't buying that one.
And Waltman did.
And unless Waltman, well...
He did fuck Chyna.
So he has fucked a man before.
Yeah.
Okay. All right. Waltman's a big fuck up, and I'm not going to, at this point, give him credit for him singing the blues about that he was molested.
He wants somebody to pay attention to him for 34 seconds.
Yeah, we're just now hearing about this. He's been a fuck up all of his life.
I'm sure that TMZ gave him some amount of money for an interview that he desperately needed for The Rock.
At least if I need money, I can go make a report somewhere that a panda bear tried to fuck me at the Louisville Zoo in 1984.
Do they have pandas in 84?
I don't know.
You should check into
that before I make the report.
Yeah, yeah.
If not, it was a polar bear I couldn't see. They got me from behind.
Polar bears will do that.
I couldn't see. I just saw white paws.
All right, so Waltman...
I think we got a case.
I think we do. So Waltman likes it in the ass. I've known that for years. What else you got?
I don't know if you guys heard about the high spots and flare...
We sounded real sympathetic on the Waltman issue, didn't we?
Yeah.
Fuck Chyna. Fuck him. Anybody fuck Chyna will fuck a man anyway. So.
I don't know if you guys have heard about the high spots and flare lawsuit going on.
I've heard a little bit about it, that he owes them a chunk of money, or they claim he owes them a chunk of money. What do you got?
So apparently what has happened with this is Flair has given High Spots his NWA title belt in collateral.
Oh, no, no. Oh, what a fuck up. No, no.
That's
the only thing in the wrestling business now that's worth any fucking thing is that belt.
So, and apparently High Spots, they gave him a little bit over $60,000 or something like that.
Fuck!
Well, I heard a court ordered him to pay X amount, right. 30 grand or something.
Well, they ordered him to pay all of the money back. Well, pay like 30 grand and I think like over 2,000 autographed photos.
Yeah, he was supposed to sign a shitload of pictures too, right?
And he didn't do it. So he...
You're cutting out.
Okay. So he has been held in contempt of court.
Yeah, I heard about that.
He has 30 days to hand this stuff over or he will be arrested. So why
would he be willing to give them his title belt?
Well, and that's the funny thing. I listened to an interview from the guy that owns High Spots, and he was apparently a really good friend with Ric Flair. And he said that he had found, because he's a lawyer too, and he said that he had found out when filing for this lawsuit that the belt had been previously used in an unpaid debt. So he had done this with somebody else, too, and didn't pay him back.
Uh-huh.
So, you know, I don't know what's going to come of that. Flair may not even get that back.
It ain't looking good, is it?
No. That motherfucking thing would be in a safe with an armed guard if I had it.
It's just another addition, another sad addition of Ric Flair's life, man.
Yep.
That is, I never dreamed that this would ever happen to Ric Flair.
Nate.
So now that we've got the wrestling stuff out of the way, I've got some questions that probably Chris is going to have a good time answering.
Go right ahead, quickly.
Kind of some auto, some car news.
Alrighty.
The Obama administration is set to impose a corporate average
fuel economy of 62 miles per gallon by 2025 this fall.
It'll never happen.
I've actually heard about this to a degree. A lot of British automakers, Aston Martin is even doing it. A lot of international automakers are, to where they are trying to make a lower-level model. Porsche's talking about it, so that they can actually still sell their sports cars. I think that it's stupid. It'll stifle the industry. Miles per gallon isn't the problem. No matter what a car gets, it is how you drive. My dad drives a V8 Cadillac with a 3.8 liter in it, I think.
Yeah, I believe so.
And he gets, on average, what, close to 30-something miles?
On the highway, I've been known to get as much as 31.8 miles a gallon.
Yeah, and that's in a humongous V8, but it's how you drive.
But it's how I drive it. If Chris drove the same car, he'd probably be lucky to get 22.
Yeah, and it's because we drive differently. Top Gear, one of my favorite shows in the world, did a study where they took a BMW M3 and they followed around a Toyota Prius, the hybrid thing. They had the Prius go as fast as it could around their track, which isn't too fast, because it's a fucking Prius, and they just had the M3 drive to keep up with it. The M3 got, on average, 19 or 20 miles a gallon, while the Prius only got 17, because it has such a small engine next to that electric engine. If the electric engine isn't doing anything under load, it doesn't matter. It's such a small engine, the compression is so high, it needs more fuel. The tank is smaller, you have to make more stops, you have to fill up more. It is ridiculous to think that hybrids and smaller displacement engines are the way of the future. If you want to see what's actually going to work, look back in time at Japan. The K cars from the 90s and the early 2000s, the Suzuki Cappuccino, just look up K cars, K-E-I cars, from Japan, the Honda Beat, all those, the AutoZam AZ1, shit like that, they got an average 65 miles a gallon using a 0.6 liter engine. And they were all very powerful, very fun to drive cars. They had people carriers, sports cars, convertibles, anything, you name it. If you needed it, you could get it in a K-car fashion. And they were there for certain Japanese tax laws. And they were great. But we're completely ignoring those right now. The old Honda CRX got something like 50 miles a gallon. And the new hybrid CRZ can't even crack 40. So the fact that we're not looking at cars that we've already had is just disgusting, and it shows that there's no actual motivation. It pisses me off. Fuck Obama for trying to control the industry. I hope he gets fucking shot. What else you got?
Kind of on the Honda thing, what do you think about their new fuel cell cars?
The hydrogen fuel cell, yeah. It will probably be what saves motoring. By the way, I don't actually wish any ill on Obama. I think he's a great president.
I don't wish him to be shot.
No, I just...
Shooting a president ain't good. Nothing good ever happens.
No, it's just incredibly frustrating. It's just incredibly frustrating that they're trying to do this to my industry that I love. I mean, this is what... I got gasoline running through my veins, and I don't like the people trying to control this industry. I wish no ill will upon the president. I think he's doing a fine job overall. I think he gets a lot of bad shit from people who just want to fucking argue. And on the auto thing, I'm one of those people. But overall, the hydrogen fuel cell cars are probably going to be what saves motoring. It's probably what is going to allow the petrol engine to survive. I wish that the Honda Clarity would be released internationally already. I think California's test market has done well for it. I don't think that the sales are very high because it's just not a very viable option outside of Los Angeles. But I think if you give it a few more years, if you let the market build up, it'll be great. I support it 100%, and I have even thought about buying one just to support that market to make sure there are petrol cars left for me to buy and for my kids to buy.
Cool. Any other car news on your end that you'd like to talk about?
Not really. I got nothing, to be honest. I haven't really read too much news this week. I've been kind of just relaxing.
Gotcha. And then kind of to end things off here, I've got a... kind of a sports news, but it's been more, you know, headlining a lot of stuff. But, Kenny's going to get a kick out of this, the Jim Tressel and Ohio State debacle.
I have no idea what either of those things are.
Well, Jim Tressel lied about a shitload of stuff, and he was a saint and this god to coaching football in the Ohio State Buckeyes. Turned out he was getting his players deals on cars and all kinds of other illegal shit that he was involved in. So finally he resigned, is what they say, but I got a feeling the university put it out. Now I hear the quarterback quit today. those five players that were going to come back after their five-game suspension. Well, I hear the quarterback of Ohio State says he's not coming back. He's going to try and play Canadian football. I'm sure the other four little cocksuckers aren't far behind him. I doubt we're going to see them either. And what in tune was your question?
What do you think's going to happen to Ohio State after this?
Well, I know USC had to give up their national championship from 04 today, or whatever year they won that, 07, whenever it was. Whenever Bush was there, they had to give up that national title. And Ohio State, they're probably going to have a bit of an uphill climb. They got a bit of a stink on them right now. Gotcha. And but, you know, they're big and they got a lot of money, and, you know, they'll buy their way out of it like all the other universities do. And the BCS is just as corrupt as the NCAA is, so it doesn't really matter. You know, it's just two corrupt organizations, and one's trying to shank the other one.
And do you think UK and Calipari are next?
I can only hope. I can only hope. All I know is that, I'm telling you, I'm giving everybody a scoop right here. Ohio State, they got busted because their players were getting deals on cars. Here's the little hint I'm going to give you. John Calipari, Wildcat players, and Paul Miller Ford. I've given you all you need. Investigators, go to town.
Well, there went our deals.
Well, fuck them.
I wanted a boss, but I guess not now.
Yeah, not now. Not after NCAA gets done digging through that paperwork.
Fuck.
There you go, NCAA. Have fun.
All right.
Paul Miller Ford. If you want a deal, be a Wildcat.
Yeah, you know something corrupt is going on when you're getting like 50% of the top recruits in the nation.
Well, yeah.
You're talking about UK or Ohio?
Both of them.
Both of them.
I don't know anything about
and them. USC and Pete Carroll, and of course Pete Carroll. And you know, hardly anything even remotely bad happens to these coaches. They fuck up the programs and get a slap on the wrist. Calipari did it to Memphis. They had to forfeit all the big wins they ever had. And UK thinks that that little slimy bastard's changed his colors already. I got news for you.
Well, he did it at he did it at Massachusetts too.
Well, of course he did, because that's what he does. But and that shows you the integrity that UK has. Even if he has changed his colors, and even if he did promise never to do it again, that shows you how desperate the University of Kentucky is that that's okay. We'll take your slimy little history. We'll take all your crookedness. We'll take the fact that the two schools he coached before us have had to forfeit all their major wins and all their tournament wins because we got to win or our student body won't come watch us play. Our fundraisers will go away. Our boosters will go away. We got to win.
I will say one more thing about Japanese wrestling. Dragon Gate finally, after 3 years of being absolutely worthless, he's managed to be interesting again. Anybody who wants to watch actual good lucha, watch Dragon Gate. It's good shit.
I'll have to take your word for it.
iHeartDG.com is a great way to follow it.
All right. Well, any closing words, guys?
For the absolutely nobody that listens to the entire hour and a half of this, thank you.
Yeah. One ball with a 90-minute time limit.
Like fucking hero, Matt.
And I still need medication for my leg. So, Mr. Rob Dickless, I said good day.